Next on Unsolved Mysteries. In Phoenix, a cocktail waitress marries a wealthy cattle rancher. After his death, someone enters her house and a tape recording may be the key to her killer's identity. Jill Jensen had a problem, a $500-a-day cocaine habit that was destroying her life. Why would she go to a tiny mountain village in Eastern Europe for a cure? In Louisiana, intruders brutally murder a young couple while they sleep. Some say they are the victims of a satanic cult. And after a cold beer at a country western bar, Marianne Perez disappeared without a trace. 15 years later, a mysterious caller claims that not only is she still alive, but she's being held against her will. Our team is standing by, and maybe someone watching can help bring in one of these bad guys. And you know what? It could be you. I'm Dennis Farina. Join us. She was a waitress. He was a wealthy cattleman from one of the most prominent families in Phoenix. Theirs was a fairy tale romance and marriage until he died and someone wanted her dead too. Jeannie Gunter was born in Arkansas and got married right out of high school. She eventually divorced and wound up in Phoenix working as a cocktail waitress. But she had much higher ambitions than that. Jeannie got her real estate license and was immediately successful. Then she met Edward Tovery, a charming, wealthy divorcee.
I think you're going to do well because of your people skills. I bet you're good at.
Ed had all the qualities that Gene was looking for.
I'd like to propose a toast.
It's just that simple. You have to kiss a lot of frogs before you find the prince. And she considered Ed a prince.
The Tovery family made millions in the cattle business and were among the founding fathers of Phoenix. But Ed Tovery made his own name as a pilot in World War II. Less than a year after they met, Jeannie and Ed were married, and Jeannie was warmly accepted into the Phoenix upper crust.
She seemed to fall right into it, as if though she'd had that money forever. She was welcomed and very, very well loved. I don't know one person that disliked Jeannie. She was just one of those very special people with very special qualities.
She treated people like she wanted to be treated. They entertained a lot, very casual entertaining, had friends in. They had a very good marriage. They both liked to do the same things.
10 years after getting married, Ed's health began to decline. Jeannie was by his side constantly.
I just want to make sure you're taken care of. You get the house and you're comfortable, okay?
Gene was not a greedy person. It wasn't like, well, I have married you. Everything you have is mine. This was not Gene.
When Ed eventually died, he left Jeannie an estate worth millions, including the house and a valuable art collection. After a period of mourning, Jeannie re-entered the Phoenix social world.
I think it was her way to get over everything and meet people. Became quite the socialite and chaired many of the balls, and her circle of friends all went. For Jeannie, it became a way of doing things for herself.
Well, I'm going to finish these last few invitations and call it a night.
On the last evening of her life, Jeannie prepared invitations for a high society party she planned to host. At 7 p.m., she spoke with her sister. By 1 a.m. the next morning, she was dead, shot in the head 5 times. At the murder scene, police found several fingerprints, but no other physical evidence. Jeannie's purse, identification, and credit cards were all missing.
Those credit cards have never been found, and they've never been used to this day. The fingerprints that we have been compared to every name that's been mentioned to us, that's been through our computer system, and we have not identified who those prints belong to. My opinion, and that opinion of two detectives, all felt that she was the victim of a hit. She was killed intentionally for somebody.
Police were sure the killer was someone familiar with Jeannie's neighborhood because he entered her home so easily.
I would say the suspect at least had some knowledge of the house. Entry into the house was made through a window, but it was done in a manner not to set the alarm system off. There's white carpeting throughout the house, and there was no indications in any room except her bedroom that anybody had been in there. It appears that he knew the direct path from the point of entry to her bedroom and where she was. She was shot while she lay in bed asleep. There was no obvious signs of a struggle.
Police believed that the killer scattered Jeannie's costume jewelry to make it look like a burglary. Thousands of dollars worth of real jewelry was left untouched in the next room. Also, it seemed that he wanted someone to know that he had been there.
The alarm was set off when the sliding door was opened by the suspect. It's only a theory, but one of the reasons we considered is that this person, if he was paid to kill her, wanted to let the person who paid him know that the job was done.
Why was Jeannie Tovery killed? Police had no idea until they listened to the tapes from her answering machine.
Yes, Jeannie, this is Gordon Phillips.
That's when they heard the voice of a mysterious man who called himself Gordon Phillips.
And I have some information for you.
Phillips claimed to be a magazine writer. He met with Jeannie saying that he wished to interview her about her late husband's POW experiences.
Tell me something about Ed himself, your husband, the man. What was he like?
Mr. Phillips, you say you work for Time Life.
Yes.
Well, then, of course, you would have some identification you could show me.
Well, actually, I'm a freelance writer. I'm not really on staff. I can provide you with some references.
You know, I'm going to have to cut you short.
Jean had him checked out, and Time Magazine. He had never heard of him. And Jean once again told him that she was the wrong person to talk to. She couldn't seem to make him understand this.
Gordon Phillips would not give up. If Jeannie didn't answer his calls, he left messages on her machine.
Hello?
And she was sure that he was following her.
Mr. Phillips, I told you I do not want to meet with you.
For a while there, it was every time she went somewhere, she'd think she saw this guy. She would see him in a crowd, and she was extremely nervous about this.
Yes, Jeannie, this is Gordon Phillips checking back. It's about 3:30.
It's inconceivable to me that Jean was murdered. She was my sister, she was my best friend, and she didn't deserve to die.
Update. After a 7-year investigation, the man who called himself Gordon Phillips has been identified as Jeannie Tovery's killer. His real name is James Cornell Harrod, and his fingerprints match those found at the crime scene. Harrod was found guilty of first-degree murder. Because it was a contract killing, he was sentenced to death. However, the person who hired him to murder Jeannie is still a mystery. If you can help bring this case to its final conclusion, please contact us at unsolved.com. Next, a young woman strung out on cocaine searches for a miracle. What brought her to this tiny town in Eastern Europe?
Oh,
Former model Jill Jensen is so strung out on cocaine that she has gouged open sores all over her body. Rita Klaus, a mother of three, attempts to overcome the crippling effects of multiple sclerosis. These two women really have nothing in common, but a small village called Medjugorje. Millions of pilgrims, many of them Americans, have come to this church in Medjugorje to meet six young people who call themselves visionaries. They claim to have spoken to the Virgin Mary on this hill outside of the village in 1981. Decades after the vision, hundreds of people claim they have been healed here. Joe Romano swears that he was cured of abdominal cancer. Kevin Gibo had a failing immune system, but now his symptoms have disappeared. Char Vance's leg was shattered beyond repair. Now, it's healed. It's hard for many of us to believe that an injury or illness can be cured by a visit to a religious site. But for many who have watched a loved one suffer, sometimes their only hope is a miracle. And that's why they travel to Medjugorje. As a pretty teenager, Jill Jensen wasn't in an accident. She didn't have a life-threatening disease. She had a different problem. She was addicted to cocaine.
I don't think that many days ever went by without me using cocaine. I'd carry it in my purse, I'd conceal it in my jackets, I'd hide it in my car. I would never go anywhere without it.
By the time Jill was 26, she had a $500 a day habit. She tried one drug rehab center after another, but nothing helped.
It got to the point where I began to hallucinate. I would start to see bugs all over me, or what I believed to be bugs. I would feel things all over me and think that I had to get them off of me. No matter what I did, I just had to get these bugs off of me. So I would rip my skin open and rip out my hair. And for years, I had these sores all over me.
She was scrawny. She was anorexic. She had circles under her eyes. She looked far beyond her years. You know, one time, Jill was beautiful, and all heads would turn when they saw her, and she did modeling for a while. But all that left her.
Jill's Aunt Didi had made a pilgrimage to Medjugorje. A year later, she convinced Jill to go back with her. Jill agreed, even though she dreaded a 14-hour plane ride without access to cocaine.
I didn't know how I was going to handle the withdrawals. I've been through them before. Horrible headaches, sleeplessness sometimes. Terrible nightmares when I am able to sleep. Cold sweats, hot flashes, horrible things. I didn't know how I was going to make it, but I was willing to try. Something came over me that gave me the willingness to try.
When Jill arrived in Medjugorje, she met with an American priest in a makeshift confessional.
I'm not really sure what I'm supposed to do here.
You say, "Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned," my last confession was.
Although raised a Catholic, Jill had never been interested in religion.
My last confession was when I was 8 years old.
For nearly an hour, lines backed up while Jill made her confession.
Without the drugs, I couldn't do anything without the drugs. And right around then, that's when the bugs started. And I'll do anything to get them off me.
It was evident to him that I was all torn up. And I had told him how I had arrived at having all these sores, these open wounds. And when I was through with my confession, he blessed my sores with holy water.
Amen.
By that evening, all my sores were completely closing and healing. It was amazing. I didn't feel it happening, but every time I'd look down, I would notice that they were less and less open, the sores. And for years, they'd never, ever gone away.
Within a few days, Jill's sores had almost disappeared, and she hadn't experienced a single symptom of withdrawal.
For the first time in my life, I felt like I had been freed, that I really was going to be able to have a life, that it was given back to me. It was a gift.
Years after her trip to Medjugorje, Jill is still drug-free, and she speaks in school drug prevention programs. Rita Klaus also believes in the healing power of Medjugorje. She told us she experienced it without ever leaving her own home. Rita had been a nun until the onset of multiple sclerosis, or MS, a degenerative, incurable disease. When her symptoms worsened, Rita left the convent and moved to Pennsylvania, where she taught school. She soon met Ron, another teacher, and 3 years later they were married. Then, Rita's symptoms disappeared. She came to believe that she had been misdiagnosed. Within 5 years, Ron and Rita had 3 daughters. But after the birth of their youngest, Heidi, Rita began to experience symptoms of MS once again. She tried to ignore them. But one day, the muscles in her right arm weakened uncontrollably.
Thankfully, Heidi was all right. Outside of being shaken up, she was all right, but I was not all right. I was so shaken inside and so afraid, just terribly afraid.
In time, Rita was restricted to a wheelchair, and on good days, crutches.
Okay. Often I would look at the books about Medjugorje and I would think, I would love to be there. And then I would look at myself and say, but physically there's no way I could go. Financially there's no way I could go. And so I didn't go.
Then one night while she was saying her prayers, she heard a voice. And she began to pray.
Dear Mary.
As soon as I finished the prayer, I felt this feeling through my body like electricity, but it was especially intense on the right side of my body where I had deformities in the right leg. I thought, this isn't happening to me, and I fell asleep.
Curiously, the next morning, Rita had no memory of the voice or saying a prayer. As usual, she headed off to her class at the local college.
Midway through the class, I felt this rush of heat through my body. And by the end of class, I could feel there were wrinkles inside my shoes. I could move my toes. I had not been able to move my toes for years.
Ron? Girls?
It had been 4 years since Rita had walked on her own without help.
As I stood there looking at the steps, I had a flashback. And in that flashback, I heard the voice from the night before, the prayer that was given me to say. And I knew I was completely healed. I ran all the way up the steps. And I remember I was screaming at the top of the steps. And then I ran down the steps, out the front door. I was screaming at the sky, oh, thank you, God. Oh, thank you, Blessed Mother.
Look, I can walk.
You're really thinking that you're not seeing what you're actually seeing. You want to be happy, but you're almost afraid to be happy. Because every doctor that you've ever seen has said it would never happen.
See how that feels.
Okay.
Right. Rita's symptoms have not returned for over 20 years. She's even able to ice skate again. She believes it's a miracle.
This certainly could be called a miraculous event, if you want to use that term, because we just don't see 20 years of disability clear instantly.
Can cures like Rita's and Jill Jensen's be attributed to the Virgin of Medjugorje? The Catholic Church has not recognized them as miracles, but it's hard to argue with them when they say they were healed by a miracle of faith. Next, in high school, she was voted the most popular and the prettiest, a cheerleader and a homecoming queen. Why would someone want her killed? Sulphur, Louisiana. In junior high and high school, Pam Littleton was voted the most popular, the friendliest, and the prettiest girl. She was a cheerleader, and she was the homecoming queen. After college, Pam married Eric Ellender, a bright, up-and-coming businessman. They bought a house near Pam's parents, and Eric went to work for Pam's father. A year later, Pam gave birth to a baby girl, and the family circle was now complete. Nearly every day, Pam would walk over to her parents' home with the baby for a visit.
Pamela, I guess, would be, she was the type of daughter that every father would dream of. She had dreamed of being a housewife and a mother. That was her ambition in life, and she was totally happy.
More like 11.
It was 8:45 p.m. on February 11th, the Monday before Mardi Gras. Pam's husband, Eric, called her at her mother's to say that he was home from work. Pam left for home 30 minutes later. The next afternoon, Huey Littleton got a call from his mother-in-law.
She says, "Huey, I just left Pam and Eric's, and something's wrong. They're in their bed. I have the baby and I'm back at your house. Call the sheriff." The sheriff's unit met us at the gate going into the yard and asked that we not go near the house. We learned that Pam and Eric were dead. Both of them had been brutally shot with a shotgun and had the fatal wounds were to their head.
The only blessing was that Pam and Eric's daughter was left unharmed. But Pam's parents were consumed by grief.
Totally immobilized me. I couldn't cry. All I could do was say why and who.
Eric's car had been stolen the night of the murders. 18-year-old Chris Prudhomme and three of his friends were seen driving it in Baton Rouge. Prudhomme was arrested.
Chris, where was the shotgun?
It's in a case.
And became the focus of the investigation.
So what did you do after you got the gun and saw that it was loaded?
I went and shot him.
Who did you shoot first?
I shot the guy.
He confessed under oath that he had killed Pam and Eric. He had no remorse for doing so. In fact, was glad that he did so.
17 days after the murders, Prudhomme was found hanging by the neck in the jail shower room. In this suicide note found in his cell, Prudhomme took sole responsibilities for the murders. He said, quote, "I enjoyed very much in the taking of these two individuals' lives." As far as the sheriff's department was concerned, the case was closed. But to Huey Littleton, there were too many questions left unanswered. Huey is a licensed private detective, and he began his own investigation. Huey came to believe that Chris Prudhomme was a member of a satanic cult called the Skaters, an acronym for Satan's Kids Against the Establishment.
Because I'm not going down for this.
I'm not either.
Look, he's not going to talk if he knows better.
He doesn't know what he's
the
talking.
Girlfriend of one of the skaters told Huey about a meeting that took place the morning after Pam and Eric were killed.
We got to come up with something. Now, we know he wasn't alone, but what about the cops, okay?
The witness said the skaters were trying to make up an alibi for whoever was with Prudhomme when the murders happened.
By himself, right?
She also said that Prudhomme and one accomplice had broken into the Allenders' home, planning only to burglarize it.
Check this out.
But she said they were high on LSD and ended up murdering Pam and Eric using one of Eric's shotguns.
I was at a bar that night, and I was drinking.
Huey felt that many of the crucial facts were still unknown. He continued to interview more witnesses, well over 100 of them.
And they mentioned something about a party.
He was horrified when a girl named Nikki Alderson told him that just minutes after the murders, the skaters were having a party in Pam and Eric's house.
When we got out to this house, I saw some people, and when we walked up to them, I'd realized I knew some of them.
Nikki said one of the first people she saw at the party was Chris Prudham.
Hey, Chris, man.
What's
going
up? Not much.
Whose place is this?
I don't know right now.
All right.
They were all just standing around drinking and talking and making different remarks about God and things like that. You can kind of feel from the vibes of people, you know, something, it was kind of weird because everybody was in their, you know, like I said, in their own little world.
I just got here, let me see what I can get. I didn't get a lot.
Some were doing some drugs on the table. They had enough drugs on there where I could see from a distance of what they were snorting.
Thanks, that's what I want.
Nikki claims she did not know there were two dead bodies in the house until she was watching television the next day.
I was watching the news and I saw this house and I was like, oh my God, I was at that house. Then I knew, you know, that was the guys that was there, that was the people I'd seen, and I just come to realization that I was there.
We were asked by Mr. Littleton to relook at the case, and we did, and everything that he let us know about, we checked into and found out it didn't have factual information enough to bring to the district attorney's office. Also, everything that we reviewed, the district attorney reviewed, and so has the attorney general of the state of Louisiana reviewed, and its facts speak for itself.
The sheriff's department says they saw no evidence that there was a party at the house. However, Huey found one other person who confirmed Nikki's story. This witness added sickening details, claiming that the dead bodies of Pam and Eric were molested sexually by more than one person. Those claims were backed up by this man, Chip Richard. Although he was not at Pam and Eric's house, he saw videotapes of what took place that night.
What I saw on the video was the people killing the elders, having sexual contact with them, you know, just basically everything that really goes on, you know.
This is about as low as humanity can crawl.
Next, more witnesses come forward with strange and disturbing testimony. The investigation into the murders of Pam and Eric Ellender continues. Pam and Eric Ellender have been brutally murdered. When Pam's father investigated, he uncovered allegations of a satanic cult and events more sinister than he would ever have imagined. The confessed killer, Chris Prudham, was dead, apparently a suicide. Now attention focused on 18-year-old Robert Adkins. He was one of the three men arrested with Prudham in Baton Rouge. Adkins was charged only in connection with the theft of the vehicle. But according to a friend, there was much more.
Bobby took me in the backyard. He told me that he wanted to tell me what had happened because he needed to get it off of his chest.
What happened is me and Chris.
While on bail, Adkins allegedly told Sean Moody that he was at the house when Chris Prudham killed the Ellenders.
When we get in, we just headed straight to the living room.
He told me they were looking around for valuables, him and Chris, and they had found a shotgun. And when they entered the master bedroom, the wife woke up. Chris shot the wife first, and then the husband had woken, and Chris shot him.
According to Chip Richard, Adkins said that Prudham didn't murder anyone, but had volunteered to take the fall out of loyalty to the satanic cult.
He had told me that, Chris was taking the rap for him because Chris was becoming the leader in the cult. Basically, everybody that was with him worshipped him and, you know, would do anything for him. And in return, he had to do for them the same that they would do for him.
Kim came to me about one or two days after the murders.
Huey interviewed more witnesses, looking for someone who can identify the actual shooter. Finally, he found Pearl Fruget. Pearl said her cousin Kim Manuel claimed to have witnessed the murders firsthand. Huey wanted Kim's story tape recorded and asked Pearl to help.
Do you think we can get her to talk about it on tape?
Chris, one other girl, and another guy were in the house.
The next day, Pearl recorded a conversation with Kim's permission. Kim described the murders in detail, but never admitted on tape to actually being in the house herself.
Chris bumped something and Eric woke up. I guess he went to grab for the gun and Chris shot him. Then Pam woke up and the other guy shot her. Chris was gonna kill the baby too, but the girl told him no. She took the baby and brought it into Pam and Eric's room and laid it down with them. And then she went outside. I've been getting threats about this, Pearl. What am I supposed to do?
Pearl played the tape before a grand jury.
And now, the actual tape.
Kim, what really happened that night? You know he's been calling me and threatening me. I'm really scared.
This to us was a pinnacle point in the investigation. After hearing a lot of testimony, I mean from many witnesses, the grand jury returned an indictment of 2 counts of second-degree murder against Kim Manuel.
They went to the baby's room, and I guess they couldn't find anything.
Some believe the indictment was a legal maneuver to pressure Kim Manuel into identifying other possible suspects. If so, the plan failed. Kim Manuel's court-appointed public defender, John Laverne, called a press conference. He claimed that Pearl Fruget was lying and the tape had been scripted and rehearsed.
She and Kim then concocted this story that they wanted to hear. And then she produced the tape recorder openly and showed it to Kim. And they sat there with a scripted conversation and recorded it and brought it back and gave it to these people, that being what they wanted to hear.
They went into the
Pearl Fruget stands by her story.
We never made up the tape. I never lied. What I told them was the truth. And Kim knows it's the truth. I can't change what she told me. And I'm not gonna make up another story just to make her look good.
1 year later, the charges against Kim Manuel were dropped. Huey Littleton was bitterly disappointed. And by now, he had lost all credibility with the authorities.
We felt sorry for him at first, but we got to deal with facts. When you go before a judge and a jury, he won't be able to bring all these accusations. He'll have to deal with facts. And I think any grand jury, any district attorney, any attorney general would agree with that.
I'm at peace with what I'm doing because we're doing the right thing. We just want to see those that participated in the murders of Eric and Pam and the cover-up and the destruction of evidence brought to justice, justice under the law.
Robert Atkins and 2 other men were indicted in connection with the murders of Pam and Eric Allender. Atkins pled guilty to manslaughter. He was sentenced to 21 years, but the sentence was reduced to 5.5 years because he had already served time on the stolen car charge. The other 2 men served short terms as accessories after the fact. So now the Attorney General's office in Louisiana considers this case closed. But Huey Littleton will not rest until he knows exactly what happened on the night of the murders. If you have any information, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, a mysterious phone call reopens the case of a woman missing for 15 years. Chalmette, Louisiana.
I want you to feed everybody for me.
Yeah.
And
Would you put everything in the fridge when you're done?
Marianne Perez goes out with a girlfriend and leaves her teenage daughter, Donna, to babysit the younger children.
I love you. I'm going to call and check up on you.
Okay. She told Donna that she would be calling to check on us about 10, 11 o'clock. And Donna said she got a phone call from Mama first. State Mama said that she was okay, she'd be home shortly. And then Donna said she got a phone call from a woman by the name of Dorothy.
Hello?
Hi, my name's Dorothy and I'm a friend of your mama's. I'm calling to let you know she's having car trouble, so she'll be a little late getting home tonight.
When I heard about the call and heard the name Dorothy, I couldn't imagine who in the world that could have been. I knew there was something wrong somewhere. The car being practically new and no reason for car trouble.
Marianne never called and never came home. Her family soon discovered that she had gone to meet her friend at a country western bar on the outskirts of New Orleans. The next morning, police found Marianne's car parked in front of the club, but found no evidence of car trouble. 3 days later, Marianne's purse was found in Lake Pontchartrain, 10 miles away. It had been weighted down by a brick, but there was no trace of Marianne Perez. 9 years passed. Then, finally, New Orleans police got their first solid lead. A man named David Courtney and his wife had confessed to a multi-state killing spree. One of their victims seemed to have a lot in common with Marianne Perez.
I was going to this bar for a drink, and I saw this woman, and...
When I went up to Kansas to interview David Courtney, he told me about the female he abducted in New Orleans. He stated that he was driving down the highway and pulled in a parking lot of a country western bar.
Oh.
Oh.
Hey, you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. Thank you.
You're not driving that car, are you?
I gotta get home to my kids.
Well, look, why don't you let my wife and I take you home? She's right up the road here and picking her up from work.
Did you pick your wife up?
Yeah, and then we took her straight to our trailer.
He stated that this female fell asleep on a chair in the trailer, and there were some sexual advancements by David Courtney's wife, which woke this female up, and she became disturbed and irate and upset about what was going on, and they agreed to give her a ride home at that time.
David Courtney stated that his wife drove, and he sat in the back seat with their intended victim.
Taking you back, and it's all over. You can see it.
Courtney said he had already killed once, and that he and his wife were afraid that this woman would go to the police if they let her live.
Recognize this place. This is not the way to go. This is not.
According to David Courtney, they dumped their victim near the Louisiana-Mississippi state line and made no attempt to hide the body. Detective Lambert tried to verify that their victim was actually Marianne Perez.
I'm gonna show you a photograph now. I want you to take a look at it and see whether or not you can identify this person.
Could be, yeah, it kinda looks like her. I can't be 100% sure, but yeah, I think so, maybe.
I'm going to show you a smaller photograph. I want you to look at it and see if you recognize anything in that photograph.
Well, yeah, that's her car. It's green. Definitely.
Detective Lambert next questioned Courtney's wife specifically about Marianne's purse.
I asked her if the female he abducted had a purse, and she said yes, that she threw it over the side of a bridge that they were crossing at the time.
Get her out, quick. I got it.
An extensive search was conducted, but no body was recovered, even though all of Courtney's other victims had been found where he said they would be found. The Courtneys were never charged with Marianne's murder. Her family kept their hopes alive. Then, 15 years after Marianne disappeared, the family got a phone call from a woman who claimed to be Marianne's best friend.
And she said, well, it's about Marianne. And I said, what about Miss Marianne? And she said, well, Miss Marianne's still alive.
I'm calling for Marianne because they won't let her call. Marianne can't remember. Look, but you have Donna's number.
The caller insisted she would not be able to call again. She said, like Marianne, she was, quote, not allowed.
You, Marianne is still alive. I don't understand why you don't want to help her.
That caused me to think, you know, more positive that she was alive. Of course, there was statements made that it's possibly a prank call. I don't know. But I do know that if she is alive, I'd like to see her, you know, and I'd like to find her.
Marianne's family clings to the hope that David Courtney, who admits he was drunk at the time, did not succeed in strangling Marianne to death.
Maybe he might have strangled her unconscious, thinking that she was dead, and threw her out. Maybe she got up several hours later. Maybe there's a possibility that she is somewhere out there.
Maybe she had amnesia or something like that, or maybe some of the brain cells were, you know, destroyed, and she can't remember who she is or what she was. I don't know what happened to her. The fact is she's gone and has been gone for 15 years. Whether she's dead or alive, I don't know.
David Courtney is currently serving a life sentence for the murder of one of his other victims. His wife served 10 years for being his accomplice. Marianne Perez has reddish brown hair and blue eyes. She is 5'4", and at the time of her disappearance weighed 108 pounds. If you have any information about the disappearance of Marianne Perez, please log on to our website at unsolved.com.